Hi, everyone, and welcome to this special edition of The Lineup. Today is October the 9th, 2023, and very glad to have my dear friend and brother, Amir Sarfati, on with us. I know most of you have heard what's going on in the nation of Israel and the attacks that are ongoing, and Amir has very graciously agreed to come on and spend some time with us and bring us up to speed and give us the real story as to what's going on, as well as how this has biblical implications in the realm of Bible prophecy. So, Amir, good to see you, my friend.
Thank you, Barry.
I hope you're getting some kind of sleep and rest, and I know it's been just an incredible time as we were together in Pennsylvania when all of this went down and awoke to all the stories breaking first thing in the morning. And it's just been quite a roller coaster ride ever since then.
Correct. Saturday morning in Israel was, or will be forever from now on. That Saturday of the last day of Sukkot will be remembered in our history as the bloodiest day since Israel was born. Bloodier than any war we ever had. And the only thing that we can compare much of what we've seen done to our people during that day, the only thing we can compare it to is the Holocaust, literally. Jews paraded in the main street and being beaten and being spat on and being, being tortured, I mean, publicly. Women, children, Holocaust survivors paraded in the streets of Gaza, people. We have never seen this before. The IDF was established to defend Israel, so we will not go through that again. And we've seen it. We may have overestimated our abilities, and we may have underestimated our enemy's abilities. We got a wake-up call, very costly one, nearly 1,000 people dead so far, and unfortunately, yeah. I must say, it will rise to at least 1,200. But it is what it is. And we have to, we have to get up and move forward. We don't have the luxury of whining and crying and sitting and do nothing. We have to get up and fight back. And that's what we do right now.
Rockets are still coming in. My Red Alert app just went off again as you were talking. So this is far from over. And Amir, if we can pause just for a moment, I'm getting all kinds of questions and emails about your family. And maybe you could just say, where you guys are and how the family is in the midst of all this great concern for your household.
Well, I believe that the major concern that I have right now is for my 10-year-old, who is a little bit suffering from anxiety from what is going on, because the television is on. We all need to see what's going on. And it's not easy for kids. I think that all of us, the adults, we've seen enough in our lives. We've seen military campaigns. We've seen bombings. We sat in bomb shelters. We fought in the military. So we are veterans of these things, although this is very unusual. But for him, this is the first real major event. And that's my major concern right now. And this is probably why I'm trying to get as fast as possible. It's not easy to find flights right now. And so, we're okay. I mean, everybody's okay. We're different locations, doing different things, which I cannot disclose.
Right.
But we're okay.
But yeah, everybody is safe, and your family, yeah. And at least as safe as they can be under the circumstances. So, Amir, we've been watching and talking about probably one of the more heinous elements of this, and that is just a wholesale slaughter of young people at a music festival. And there was some footage that came out. Somebody was actually recording as this was going down. And I watched that 3 or 4 times today. And just setting these young people up to flee in the direction where the terrorists were sitting, and just to gun hundreds of them down who were just out there to have a good time and celebrate the end of the Feast of Tabernacles. And I know we've talked a lot about this, but the details continue to emerge. And as you said at the outset, you know, this is just evil. This isn't war. This is just individual people being evil toward another people group that they hate.
It's bloodthirsty savages that they're not courageous enough to fight against soldiers that are standing against them with guns. They are so cowards that they come against women and children and unarmed civilians in the middle of a music festival out in the open. What happened there is still going to be told. I mean, we only hear very, very few testimonies. Most of the people that survived it are badly wounded. And because what happened is when they began, it was two things that happened in that music festival. People don't understand. There was rockets that began to fly. And obviously people started running to their cars to drive away. But then there was also at least 50 to 100 armed terrorists that surrounded them. And by the way, from what I understand, in one of the interrogation of the Hamas terrorists, they said they knew about this festival. They had the prior knowledge about it. So they were aiming towards that place with the knowledge that they can kill as many there. Nearly 300 people were shot to death, executed right there. And at least 50 youngsters were kidnapped from there on motorcycles, because it was in the middle of the field, so they couldn't do it with, you know, vehicles. It was just the motorcycles. And there is a video of that young girl that is being kidnapped on the motorcycle, and it's, by the way, it's on the front page of so many newspapers around the world this morning. Barry, what happened is that this is pure anti-Semitism, bloodthirsty anti-Semitic monster. Because if you really think about it, I don't believe they thought that they're going to take over Israel and kick the Jews out of the country. All they wanted is to come in, kill as many as they can, and go back. That's it.
Yeah.
It's pure bloodthirsty monster that needs some blood. That's it. That's all it happened. And I think that they did not take in consideration the fact that nothing is going to be left from Gaza and nothing will be left from Hamas. Hamas is used to see, you know, those kind of rounds of violence, and eventually there's a ceasefire, and eventually, you know, they survive and they reshape, rebuild, and rearm themselves. Finally, thank you, God. Finally, what we, the conservatives, have been saying for years, finally, everyone in Israel understands that Hamas cannot stay there with a single gun, nothing, not a rocket, not a gun, not a bomb, nothing. They must be disarmed or completely annihilated. And this is the first time since Hamas took over, although we went through at least five operations there, first time Israel is clearly designating a target to disarm Hamas. We haven't done that before. And it's not going to take a day. It's not going to take 2 days. They are armed to their teeth, and they are getting their stuff from Iran and from others, and trained. They were trained by Russia, and people still don't understand that. A lot of their capabilities and performance is stuff that we see in the Ukraine war done by Russia. And so, yeah, that's what we see right now. Israel just began. What you see now is the first 2 days of something that may last weeks and months. It's a war. It's we invoked Article 40 in our basic law of our military and our government, which means that this is the first time since 1973 where that we declare war, not operation, it's a war.
Right.
And so war has different rules. And we're going to see that.
Even Naftali Bennett came out today and said that this is 100 times worse than Yom Kippur.
Yep.
And just watching the devastation. And, you know, we had talked a little about what you just mentioned in that there were bomb-dropping drones involved here, which is technology that was exclusive to really the U.S. and Russia. And oddly enough, as you just said, I hope the international community will wake up to what you just said, because both Putin and Sergei Lavrov came out today and said, if the U.S. supports Israel, Russia will support the Palestinians.
Yeah, I mean, and
both of them just flat out said it.
And it's because they practically already do that.
Right.
They just, you know, they just don't. But, you know, again, I don't believe we're in the Ezekiel war, but I do believe that we are on this highway or freeway towards that war. Remember, in the Ezekiel war, no one comes to help Israel. And right now, America is helping Israel. America sent the USS, Gerald Ford and B-52s. And the Gerald Ford, which is the most sophisticated and advanced carrier, is coming with its strike group.
Yeah.
And that's not for nothing. You don't mobilize the biggest carrier in the world to Israel if just to show strength or show support. There is a credible information that Russia is letting Iran giving the green light to all of its proxies to go on the offense and attack Israel simultaneously. We know that that this is it, and they were very encouraged by the terrible performance of the Israeli military in the first 3 hours or 4 hours of that Saturday morning. We were caught off guard. There were two major things that we did not take in consideration. A lot of people think it's conspiracy and that Netanyahu is behind it, or I don't know, America is behind it. No. This is not true. The problem is everybody that says that because he believes that we are so amazing as a military, that how can that be? No, we actually were caught off guard. We did not even know the type of communication system that they're using. Apparently, we just found out they were using something we had no clue that they have. We did not know that they have those bomb-dropping drones. We never seen them before. I mean, there are several things, and of course, the intensity of a frequency that helped damaging the radar of the Iron Dome is also something that is only a state performance and not something of a small, you know, Muslim terrorist organization. So there's no doubt that Russia has trained them. And when I say Russia, you know, reports come that it's actually the Wagner group that trained them. But it's Russia. It's not, they're not the Swahilis. They're not, they're not from Mozambique. They are Russians and they trained them. And that's what we have right now. And we are on a clear path towards a direct confrontation with Russia eventually, Russia and Iran. And Iran is very careful. They're not sending anything from their territory. They're just letting their mad dogs do the dirty job for them because they know what's going to happen if something is going to come from Iran. But I will tell you, Barry, I believe that Israel has no other choice but somehow address the head of the snake. And because it is obvious that Iran was enabling all of that. And, you know, and without the blessing of Russia, I'm not sure it could have happened as well. So, you know, when the time comes, the snake is going to rise its head and we're going to see a much more difficult time than that.
Yeah, Amir, it's interesting. I've commented over the years how the West just doesn't seem to get it, that sitting at the negotiating table is not impressive to the Middle East. It's strength and force and all those things that we're seeing happen now in response to what's gone on. That's the language that's understood over there. And especially with the Iranians and, you know, interesting to see an article of what you just said. And you and I talked about this at length, how 50 outposts along the Gaza fence, how could they all be overwhelmed? And I read earlier today, they went in and shot those soldiers while they're sleeping. Yep. So they snuck in. And, you know, as you said, I mean, this was beyond surprise. This was just orchestrated and planned. And
it was planned for over a year, Barry, for over a year. Well, it has been planned, and it's just that they made it so secret that they didn't even let their buddies in the Islamic Jihad know about it. The only time the Islamic Jihad knew about the attack is when the attack began. And then the phone rang and they said, send your people into Israel and kidnap as many as you can, like mad dogs. And that's what they did. But Hamas, very few people knew about it. And this is our biggest, I would say, downfall as a country that has one of the strongest militaries in the world. We were caught sleeping.
An intelligence breakdown. Yeah,
the intelligence. You see, I tried to explain to people what happened is that they killed instantly on the spot every soldier around, including in the headquarters. So all the level of soldiers and command on the ground was gone. No one understood what's going on the ground because no one was there to report. And the only people that reported something are people in the party or in the cities and the kibbutzim that were surprised to see terrorists in their cities. And so they cannot call the army, they call the police. So in fact, the first people who fought against these armed terrorists were policemen and were fire brigades and, you know, people that were driving ambulances. That was the first batch of victims. And another problem, when the army realized something terrible is going on, we thought that this is a distraction and Hezbollah is about to actually invade from the north. Most of Israel's top units actually were immediately on their way to the north. Only about 2 hours into this whole thing, everybody realized nothing is happening on the north. Everything is happening in the south. It took them 2 more hours to get there. And that window of the first 4 hours is something that the Palestinians themselves say, we were surprised that it took you that long. And it allowed them, that window of time allowed them to not only go into Israel, but to go back to Gaza with all of the abductees and the kidnapped people. And so if I could go back, if we could turn the wheel and go back to that morning and just fix things, I wish we could, but we can't. And, you know, Barry, I also hear some Christians that are, they're saying that in that rave, in that music festival, there was a statue of Buddha. So it happened on a holy day of the Jews, and look where they were and look where they danced. So it's a punishment. But don't forget, we've lost nearly 1,000 people. Only 300 of them were in that rave. The rest are innocent babies and women and children, children and elderly people that were not even there. They were... I wouldn't go that far and start, you know, doing those things. You know, something terrible happened and something good can come out of it. And that's what I'm trying to focus on. Thankfully, Israel is one right now. I've never seen more unity as I see right now. No one talks politics right now. It's unity, the unity we needed so much. And it's now back in this country.
Well, especially when all you've been going through and all the unrest in the streets and all that, it's very similar to what we experienced here after September 11th. You know, this was, we were one nation again and united and you know, just interesting how these are the things that bring that about. And that is a positive that comes from it. But one of the things I think, Amir, as you were talking, I was thinking how recently it was that we were watching the attacks coming out of Gaza via incendiary balloons. I mean, they're tying a balloon filled with some type of ignition fuel to a kite and flying it over into Israeli farmland and releasing this onto. And now here we've got, from that point in time, that was not that long ago, now we're talking about bomb dropping drones. We're talking about intelligence that is next level, all these things. So, you know, I think that that's one of the things that is a little beyond concerning is who's, you know, obviously Russia's been involved, but who all has been feeding this to them and training them and taking this to this level. Just one day, all of a sudden, everything is different. And, yes, and fighting against Gaza is different than it used to be.
That's true. It's true. And again, as I said in the very beginning, we underestimated them. This was the sin of being boastful and arrogant and divided within us. Again, division always brings the house down. And think about it. Just a week ago, Israelis were fighting between themselves over prayer in Tel Aviv's, right, and over, you know, who gets to pray in publicly in Tel Aviv. Yeah. And right now, everybody is praying and everybody's together donating blood and everybody's together fixing meals for the soldiers and doing whatever they can. This we needed, I guess, this type of trauma to get back to our senses and stop this nonsense. It cost us dearly. We just began to bury our dead, and a lot of us lose sleep over what the women and children and the elderly people are going through in the hands of the Hamas. Because look, I know their culture. I know their culture very well. I've been around them enough to know that none of those beautiful young girls that were kidnapped from that party, none of them is going to go back home without having been abused sexually, physically by them. It's almost like a commandment that they have to do that. And so it just breaks our heart. But Barry, for the first time, I guess, in the history of Israel, we are conducting a war without taking in consideration that there are Israelis there. In other words, we don't let them use the abductees as a card in that war.
Right.
And it drives them crazy because they did such a big, for them, if they got in the past 1,000 prisoners released for one soldier.
Yeah.
Remember, 1,000 for one soldier. For them, they started making the calculations. Oh, so we have 100 soldiers now. So look what we can get. And now we're telling them, actually, you're going to get nothing.
Yeah.
So it drives them crazy. And I think that might drive them to go forward and maybe release children and women just to show a humane side to them, because the world has seen a side of Hamas that we knew of but no one else knew. They are ISIS, nothing less than that.
Yeah.
And if the world is so, you know, anti the barbaric and atrocities of ISIS, this is exactly the same thing.
Yeah, there's been footage. I'm sure you've seen the elderly lady who's obviously has Alzheimer's and not aware of where she is. And they're parading her through the streets. And she's smiling and yes, like, oh, well, what's the party all about? And mocking her and, you know, probably the age of someone who'd be a Holocaust survivor. So
she is, by the way, a Holocaust
survivor. She is. Okay. I figured that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Again, it's a parallel universe. And they live on another planet. The set of rules is different. You don't do peace with stuff like that. You don't. There is no peace with them because they don't even understand what it means to have peace with someone that is not like them.
Well, when you have in primary school kids being taught how to behead a teddy bear, you're raising up a generation of murderers. You know, now that's really what we're what we're seeing. And, you know, Amir, just watching all this and seeing, you know, how the international community has responded in time past, you know, that Israel's response has been disproportionate, you know, to, you know, what Hamas did.
They cannot say that anymore. They cannot say that anymore. They used to say that when we had 10 people killed and they had 1,000.
Yeah.
We have over 1,000 people killed.
Yeah.
That line cannot be used anymore.
Yeah, the other thing, I mean, we've talked a little about this. Matter of fact, this popped up in a Q&A we were doing there in Philadelphia, you know, about the Ezekiel war scenario. And the thing that I find to be curious about that is, you know, when you're going to strike in a manner that we know is coming, as the prophet has told us, you know, confusion and opportunistic type planning is certainly going to come into the picture. And you have to wonder, I think with Hezbollah on the northern border, they're acting up and you know, had some rockets fired from there. And, you know, just, yeah, I wonder who's going to try and take advantage of this unrest. I mean, we talked about that, about just the political unrest. But yes, now you've got people completely distracted. And you have to wonder, you know, who's going to try and take advantage of this? And Russia coming out and just flat out saying, you know, I think it's partially in response to the movement of the Gerald Ford and the battle group, you know, that, hey, yeah, you want to support Israel? Well, then we'll support the Palestinians. So the potential for something, maybe not necessarily the Ezekiel war, but some type of acceleration of this seems like it's pretty possible.
Well, tension is being built up, but everyone is calculating its steps right now. Hezbollah understands that if they open a war, there will be no more Lebanon, because the Israelis are not the same people as they were 5 days ago, 4 days ago.
Exactly. Yeah.
They need to understand. Every Israeli that I know is saying right now, I will sit in a bomb shelter a year if I need, until we get this done, this thing over.
Yeah.
And the Israelis are no longer saying that, oh, we have to treat them nice. Oh, we have to love, you know, not all of, no, this is over. Right now, every Israeli wants Gaza to be wiped out, you know? And I mean, everybody is waking up. This was a very, very, very traumatic event. And we're just, and so to your question, or to, you know, whatever you said, I just want to say that the level of tension is rising in the Middle East, but still at the moment, the Hezbollah knows what's going to happen to them if they're going to start a war. And by the way, look, I'm not a supporter of Joe Biden. I have never been, I probably will never be, but we must all commend him for his stand with Israel in this time. And immediately America stood by Israel, and America is assisting Israel just by ways of bringing this carrier and strike group and B-52. That's not something, I mean, I'm asking you, did America bring any carrier next to Ukraine?
No.
Did America use B-52s to help Ukraine? Absolutely not.
And we just wrote checks.
Exactly. You don't want to. What I'm trying to say is that this is beyond just saying that you support us. This is really helping in words and in actions. And make no mistake, if anyone around us thought that they can mess up with Israel simultaneously, they're rethinking that right now with this new reality of having a powerful U.S. Carrier, airplanes, bombs, and bombers right here with us. So I don't think anyone wants to mess up with the U.S. military right now.
Right.
But again, one of the things that we've been teaching for years about Ezekiel is that no one will come to help Israel in the Ezekiel war. And so,
yeah, it's true.
And so will that mighty army of America be there in the real war? No. So what we're watching now is maybe the last hour, not hour as an hour, but the last phase of the existence of America as a superpower. America is still behaving now as a superpower. America is still doing things thousands of miles away to assist other countries such as Israel right now. But it's not going to last for too long. It's not going to last. We know that. We are prepared for that mentally, and we know we're talking about it for the longest time. So when that will happen, when America is not going to be there for Israel, everybody will feel free to do what they really want to do. And right now, they can't do that. They know that they can't do that. So,
Right.
So again, terrorists will attack, but countries will not. That's a big difference. People need to understand, I mean, we are not fighting against countries right now. We're fighting against terrorist organizations that are sponsored and assisted by Iran. But these are not countries. We're not fighting against the Syrian army. We're not fighting against the Lebanese army. We're not fighting against the Iraqi army. We're not fighting against the Jordanian army, or not even the Palestinian Authority, so to speak. We're fighting against terrorist organizations, and that's not the Ezekiel War. Ezekiel is talking about nations that are coming against us. It's a different story.
Yeah. You know, we have talked a lot. I know you and I both agree that there is a generation that is the last generation. We may not know how long a generation is, lots of speculation about that. But Israel 75, and now we're seeing, you know, these types of actions, unprecedented things. And that falls right in line with everything else that we talk about concerning the Olivet Discourse. You know, the things will be on an unprecedented and continually increasing scale, including things of this nature that, you know, having never seen anything like this before, these types of tactics coming especially from Hamas, and, you know, who again has been firing homemade rockets and flying kites up until now. And things all of a sudden just went next level. And again, just reminding all of us, I think, of the lateness of the hour, and therefore people's need to be ready for that moment we're all waiting for, when the Lord's going to meet us in the air with the dead in Christ.
Yes. And we also need to never underestimate our enemies. That's another lesson I can give advice to everyone. Don't ever underestimate your enemy, and be ready and be prepared for the worst, because the worst can arrive unannounced.
Well, I mean, you guys just learned that lesson. And, you know, the United States is not in a position to defend Israel when the invasion, the national, international invasion actually happened. So a lot of speculation here, economic collapse and all that. You know, the whole collapse of the decline and fall of the Roman Empire, all the things that happened to them that caused their implosion are happening here in the United States. So, yeah, I think that's a good word of counsel. There's nobody that's exempt, especially not in this world that we're living in today. And we're in those perilous times that Paul talked about. So,
I agree.
well, Amir, I don't want to keep you. I know you've had a road trip this morning and getting ready, hopefully, to get back to your homeland. And we'll be praying that that all works out. And thank you for taking a few minutes. I know we just spent, we've had some awesome trips here lately,
Yes.
some wonderful places, and saw God move mightily, and that included this past weekend. So I know you're ready to get home, and I wish it was a different home you were going to as far as the war climate. But I know this is heavy on your heart, and I've watched
Yeah,
you
that's
agonize through this, you know.
one of the reasons that God put on my heart to stay in 2024 and to work from my country, is because I know it's heavy on my heart. I know there's going to be unprecedented things that are going to happen in this part of the world and in my country, and that's why I'm getting ready. I'm gearing up for that. Next, in a few days, I'll go to Greece and Turkey to conclude our tours there and come back home and stay home for more than a year. And yeah.
Yeah. Well, we appreciate you and all that you do. And thanks for keeping us informed. And we kind of tease about Telegram and getting people to follow on Telegram. But I want to encourage people to jump on there, because you're not going to get better news. Mm-hmm. You're not going to get it more timely either. This guy doesn't sleep. And if you want to know if he's getting any sleep, all you got to do is check Telegram and you'll know when he's awake. But I haven't seen anywhere where the coverage is better. So I encourage you to follow Telegram, follow Amir on Telegram. You'll be blessed and informed. So, well, my friend, it's been a great few weeks and a few months, actually. We've been traveling since July, and I am home now for really the rest of the year, and you will be in the not too distant future. So, hope you and pray you get some rest. And let me pray for you before we close this thing out. Lord, we thank you for our dear friend and brother and his love for you, his love for his nation, and Lord, his love for the church. And what a wonderful combination of things you've placed in this man, God. So we pray, Lord, that you would, as you had promised in your word, you give your beloved sleep, that you would give him rest in the midst of all this turmoil. And Lord, that his travels would be safe and timely, and that he could get back to his family and put the squeeze on that little 10-year-old boy, his son, who you can see his love for his dad in his eyes. I just pray, God, that all would go smoothly in this return trip home. And Lord, we thank you again for the gifts that you've given to him. Pray your hand be mighty upon him, Lord, as you continue to use him in these new ways from a home base in Israel. So we thank you again, Lord, for this time together this evening. Pray travel mercies as he heads home. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, my friend. Thank you, and we'll talk soon. God bless. Well, everybody, that's it for this week. And for this program, I should say, we'll see you on Thursday, and I'm sure there'll be much more to talk about. We'll even broaden the scope, as we always do, and talk about some things outside of what's going on, but we'll focus heavily on what's going on in Israel, as that is the proper thing to do. So with that said, you know how we close out these programs. So we'll see you here, there, or in the air. God bless you, and Lord willing, we'll see you Thursday.